was like, yep, that's her.
Okay, so. Recall. What should we recall? The two forms of Gauss's law. One is the closed integral of E dot dA, or the flux, electric flux, so at any point you have a dA and you have some electric field E. And this is completely determined by Q enclosed. I'm just going to put Q in for inside and over epsilon naught. And this very quickly translates to, using the divergence theorem, the fact that divergence of E equals rho over epsilon naught. We did a problem. Normally, you would have to do heavy integration to do a problem where you have a solidly charged object, but we could, using Gauss's law, almost not integrate at all. Okay, so that is the power of Gauss's law. Let's do another example. These are all very important examples. So sometimes, even though they're in the book, I'll redo them, the example problems on the board, just to tell you which one it is. It's an infinite plane. That's what it is. Yep, this is example 2.5. Somewhat exaggerated, but again, we can still learn a lot from that. So if you have, this is the z-axis, and I'm not drawing the borders of this object because it's meant to be the entire xy plane. So this is the plane z equal to 0, or equivalently, the xy plane. And you have a charge density of sigma on this. What is the electric field everywhere? We can use Gauss's law to solve this very easily. Let me give you two perspectives to understand the symmetry. And so you know this is just a theoretical construct. You don't have in the universe the entire xy plane filled with uniform charge. There are many problems with it. How do you assemble the charge? Never mind the fact that if it's a uniform charge on an infinite plane, you have an infinite amount of charge. Okay? But you will see by experimentation and after some theoretical consideration that if you have this big of a plane, right in the middle somewhere, away from the edges, it looks like an infinite plane. So the electric field works out to be the same value. So it has its practical use as well. So let me give you another perspective, and this is important to us. Z equals 0. So this is my plane, huh? This is my plane of charge. So this is my sigma, and maybe I should clarify. Okay, and it doesn't matter where. Let's say over here, I want to compute the electric field. A little bit of symmetry helps you from having to integrate or use complicated calculus. Okay, so which way do you think the electric field can point? If you have a plane, there's a preferred direction. Correct. Say it out loud. Normal to the plane. Right? It could point outward or inward, but this being a positive charge, you know, fields diverge, so that means this is the only way the electric field can point. Okay, that's fine. What is the functional dependence of the magnitude of the electric field? We took care of the direction. The number, Newtons per coulomb, that's what electric field is measured in. Here, in exactly the same value of Z, do you expect it to be different? It's infinitely long. Where is the origin? The whole thing is kind of arbitrary, right? I drew a line Z equals zero just to let you break that symmetry because we have to set up an axis. But so this electric field can only depend on the height from the, only possibly depend on the height from the plane. Turns out it won't even do that. So this is only a function of. Now, if I go the same distance, so let's say this is Z. If I go the same distance over here, this is of course minus Z, and over here, which way do I expect the electric field to point? Downward. Would it be the same magnitude? Yeah. It's the only thing. So in Gauss's law, it's a closed integral that we're supposed to do. We won't integrate because we'll be using symmetry, but you need to come up with a closed surface. So what we're going to do is, over here, I'm going to draw a cube. And the cube cuts through the charged plane. So over here, there is you understand the diagram? So it's a fictitious cube. There's nothing there, by the way. Yeah? Half the cube, so let me draw another perspective. If you looked at the cube head on, it'll look like this. Well, same length and height. Okay, it's a mathematical construct. There's nothing there. But what have I done? I have constructed a closed surface. That is what I have to do. So focus now, the math is kind of simple. It's the concept, okay? Is there a cube? There's no cube. We just want the electric field. We know we have to use Gauss's law. So we have to construct a mathematical closed surface. And then what we're gonna do is we're gonna do E dot dA on one side, and set it equal to Q enclosed over epsilon naught on the other side. Okay, all right. So, let me set up some language here. I'm going to call this area It's the area that is inside. It's traditionally, at least Griffith calls it a pillbox. So it's a box, and the plane of the charge intersects that box. The amount of charge inside that, the area of charge inside our fictitious pillbox is referred to as A. A for area. Okay, why do we need that? Well, that is because Q enclosed is nothing more than sigma times A. Charge density times area is total charge. So one side of the Gauss's law has been taken care of. How many sides to a cube?
Six.
How many sides will have electric flux through it?
Two,
only two, up and down. Because in these four sides, the area vector is that way, and the electric field is this way. Yeah? Here, this is my normal vector. Over here, that is my normal vector. Well, so I don't even, if I take this and dot it with that, what do I get? Just the magnitude of E. Yeah? And on this surface, the magnitude of E is a constant. So the electric field or the flux is nothing more than E times A. Yeah? So I'm going to call this region 1, this region 2. So from region 1, I get E. The integral is just E times A. I'm replacing this with that. Or at least on the top surface. E is a constant. The magnitude is a constant. I pull it out of the integral. What's the integral of dA? Just A. What contribution do I get from this side? No, I'm taking the dot product.
Oh.
E is pointing down. The normal vector is pointing down. Once again, when I take the dot product, I get 1 times the magnitude. And we know the magnitude is the same. So I get, Melissa, are we good? Chip? So if you have a positive charge, electric field lines emanate from it. If you have a negative charge, the electric field lines impinge on it. Correct? So if I have a plus charge, what is the electric field? Right? If I have a negative charge, this is a bunch of positive charges. Well, I'm assuming that sigma is positive. But if sigma is negative, that's okay. All that does is flip this. Yeah? And so it'll flip there too, because so it's very simple. I have an expression. And if I want to just solve it from here. So in particular, I could, if I want to be very formal, I can say electric field above is sigma over 2 epsilon naught z hat. Electric field below is minus sigma, because it's pointing downward. This is very precise. And that's the magnitude. Here it's pointing up, here it's pointing. You look like you have a question.
Did you just put that epsilon 0 over there?
Oh. I did?
You just did that? I mean, I
just did the whole thing, so I don't know what you mean. I didn't sneak it in.
No,
it comes from here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But did you just write it there now? I mean, I don't know. I see mine, it was not there and all of a sudden it's there.
Maybe oh, well, I see. It, I there's a glitch in the matrix. Is that clear? What is surprising about this result? Very good. There's no position dependence. 1 meter away from the plane, and a light year away from the plane, there is the same amount of electric field. That's, of course, because of the rather absurd initial condition. I'd like to say that you cannot get away from an infinite plane. So another, once again, death star, clever choice. You can get away from it. If they created a death plane, that's it, you're doomed. The tractor beam is going to get everyone. It's an equal magnitude. The entire universe is going to be dragged into it. Yeah, so it worked out. You cannot get away from an infinite plane. That's just because it's infinite, that's not, you cannot conclude that, as we'll see. You can get away from an infinite wire. You can stop seeing it. But if you have an infinite plane, it's always okay? So what we're gonna do is we're gonna build a capacitor. You've seen this before. Yeah, we won't call it a capacitor just yet. Okay, what we'll do is we'll take two planes, infinite planes. And on one of them, so let me make that very clear. Let me call this one, call this two. And this one, I put plus sigma, and this one, I put minus sigma. Yeah? Let's try to find the electric field everywhere. So due to this guy, I'll have, which I'll call as E1, I will have E1, which is sigma over epsilon naught. And same thing over here, I will have E1. This is the direction, this is just the magnitude, sigma over 2 epsilon naught. In every case, I'm only going to write the magnitude. That is due to charge plate number 1. And over here, I'll have E1 equals sigma over 2. Now I'm going to do E2. E2 points which way? Yeah. It points inward, it has the same magnitude. Correct? What happens? Yeah, so over here, when I say this, you should realize it's a zero vector. But it's kind of silly to write a vector symbol. It's a vector, all the components of this vector are zero. But in the middle, what do you have? Eventually, we'll have the parallel plate capacitor, and that's what it's going to be. So let me get the final answer boxed. And it, the electric field points from? From the positive plane to the okay, James? Good. So let's do problem 2.13. So here you have an infinitely long wire, and the question is, find the electric field everywhere. What kind of a coordinate system would you use? Cylindrical coordinate system, yeah. What kind of pillbox would you use? Cylindrical pillbox, yeah. So before we do that, well, let me do it. Remember, don't go looking for the Gaussian pillbox, huh? It doesn't exist. It's just a mathematical construct because the theorem says integral over a closed surface. So if I pick a point, which way, say over here, which way would the electric field point? Let's say it's, by the way, I should clarify, charge density, lambda, linear charge density, charge per unit length. So let's say over here, which way will the electric field point? Let's say lambda is positive. If it's negative, obviously, automatically, it'll be the flip. See, this is sigma. If the whole entire combination was negative, this would be a negative, so it points the other way. Yeah. So over here, it's going to put this way. And E will depend on what? Cylindrical coordinate? S, phi, and z. Which one?
Only S.
And isn't that true on the entire, I'm just going to write it on two sides, but isn't that true on the entire surface? Once again, well, let me take a pillbox of height H and radius S. What's the total charge enclosed in my pillbox?
H times lambda.
So what goes on Travis, what do you think I'm going to write on the right side of this equation? What is the equation that I'm trying to fill in to begin with? The one that I just erased.
Mm-hmm. Which equation is it? Yeah, use your notes.
Q
over epsilon naught. So what will go over here? Over here? What's the Q? Martin just answered. H lambda. Do we have to worry about the top and bottom? No. So E dot dA is simply when integrated becomes E times A. So E is just E, which is a function of S, possibly. And area is what? Area, the spherical area of a cylinder.
It's 2 pi r h.
Oh, not r, but s. S, h. So then the magnitude is going to be lambda over 2 pi epsilon naught 1 over s. Or written vectorially, it's going to point in the s hat direction.
What is the
area of a cylinder?
Circles, right?
It's a circle, a perimeter times the height. The perimeter of a circle is 2 pi r, h is the height. Can you get away from an infinite line? Yeah. You'll stop seeing it. It's a line, right? Stop seeing it. Are we good?
So when you say linear part density, are you referring to like that?
Well, if I cut any piece of the wire, the charge in that piece of wire will be lambda times the length of the wire.
Right.
That's lambda. I cannot define the total charge because if it's infinitely long, once again, the total charge is infinity.
I mean, this is kind of, so when you're saying line is strictly like up and down.
The entire z-axis.
I mean, I don't know. Can you think of a line as a smaller cylinder itself?
I mean,
in a 3D space.
Cylinder with r equals zero.
Okay.
No, it's a set of all points that satisfies what? X equals zero, y equals zero. It's a z-axis.
Okay.
That's what I mean.
So no, nothing in x or y.
Yeah, nothing in x or y. Okay, from the Helmholtz theorem, I think I'm redoing the video for that one to bring in more clarity. When I asked you about it, not everyone was just too happy with it, so I'm gonna clean it up. But there is the essential statement of the theorem is true, which is what? To describe a vector field, you must know its divergence and its curl. We know the divergence of the electric field. Well, it's rho over epsilon naught. It's Gauss's law. So now what we have to do is find its curl. And to find its curl, we're going to rely on the Stokes theorem. So, curl of the E field. Or I can just say curl of the electric field due to any configuration of charges is the vector sum of electric field due to a single charge. So let's take the simplest case scenario and then we'll worry about the more complicated one. So what we're going to do is what we'll do all the time. We're going to going to take one solitary charge and keep it here at the origin. So the charge Q. That means anywhere there's an electric field, which is KQ over R squared, R hat. Then I'm going to pick arbitrarily two points in space. Okay. I'm going to pick the point A, and then I'm going to pick a point B. I'm just writing it as A and B. Truly, when you do integrals, it becomes a vector. A is a vector, B is a vector, because A, to locate points in space, in three-dimensional space, you need x, y, and z. Okay? And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to do the following integral. The path integral, a to b of e dot dl. I think I can draw a nicer looking curve. You know it is arbitrary. So I don't need to just complicate it with unnecessary wiggles. It doesn't really matter. Okay? So A, B, K, Q over R squared, R hat dot DL. The good news about taking the dot product is now I don't have to worry about theta and phi, because this kills the theta and phi component of the, so I can swing around all I want. It really doesn't matter. It's almost like I'm radially going to that point. So I'm going to bring out K, Q, not the R, to do A, B, and I'm going to do dr over R squared. Now I can do a better job with A and B. I can write it as R, A, RB, the value of R at the point A, and the value of R at the point B. Correct? And what you've seen in Bankert's class and vector calculus will sort of come back to you very soon. And what's that equal to? KQ. Integral of R squared is minus 1 over R, correct? Minus 1 over R, going from RA to RB, and that is KQ, 1 over RA, minus 1 over RB. It doesn't matter what complicated path I take, I get it to be this. Immediately, I can tell something. If I do this, if I do a closed path, that means I'll have to work a little hard in closing this path, but that's easy. So you go this way, and then you come back around. Correct? Let me call this path 1, and then path 2. Yes, Travis? What's that? Well, in that case, this is through path 1, e dot dl, plus integral of path 2, e dot dl. Well, we just did path 1. That's kq, 1 over ra, minus 1 over B, plus, I know how to shift labels. All I've done is switch the starting and ending point. And what do I get? A couple of interesting things. First of all, what you have learned is the integral of E along any closed loop is
0. That in itself is very powerful. That's not quite what we wanted. It sort of is, because remember, to get divergence of E equals rho over epsilon naught, what did we actually do? We actually computed E dot dA. Use the divergence theorem. And I've told you already, I'm going to use the Stokes theorem. What does that mean? What do I mean over here? Suppose I integrate over any closed path on one hand, I can go this way. On the other hand, Stokes' theorem tells me I can do this integral. And they are the same. This is true for what? Any area. Once again, I didn't pick a specific, very careful path. What's the only way this integral can be true for any area? For the integrand to be 0. And this is the differential and integral version of Maxwell's equations, except we'll talk about Maxwell's equations. These are the equations that govern electromagnetic field. In the case when charges are not allowed to move. Remember I told you this semester is electrostatics. We'll have to modify the term slightly, but that's trivial. So we now have a complete description of the electric field. The divergence of E equals rho over epsilon naught, and the curl of E equals 0 for electrostatic. In some sense, for us at the moment, Helmholtz theorem is not important, because just from the arguments we've had, we can construct the final result of Helmholtz theorem. But according to Helmholtz theorem, this means that E should be able to be written as the gradient of U. Remember the negative gradient of U? And we'll show that explicitly here. You don't need to refer to the theorem at all. This will be called the potential, electric potential. And that is what you measure using a multimeter. All these partial differential equations go into measuring with a multimeter. Imagine how connected nature and mathematics is. You are constructing an instrument, metals and resistors and other components, things that you find in the universe that you have assembled together. And they measure something that is described by partial differential equations. These are all partial derivatives. So it is actually a very important result. So what I will do, so we're done. What I'll do the next time we meet is I will explicitly construct the electric potential. It'll be that, so you don't write this down, because I'd like to do it from scratch. It'll be negative gradient of V. If there was a curve from Helmholtz theorem, you know there would be another term. But we don't have a curve, so there's no other term. This is going to be the electric potential. This is what you're going to measure using a multimeter.